Good morning, everyone, and welcome to our Bucher Basin North America and La Matabie webinar. Today, we are going to talk about tiles and how to increase aromatic expression in wine. My name is Eglantine Chauffour. I'm the winemaking product manager for Bucher Basin North America, representing La Matabie. And I will be your speaker today. So first of all, I would like to introduce you the two partners for this webinar. So we have Bucher Vasselin, designer, manufacturer, and seller of material for grape and wine processing since 1856. They are focused on high quality and robust, innovative process, and they are present all around the world. La Matabie, French winemaking product brand established in Bordeaux in 1878, so 140 years of expertise and winemaking experience. They are focused on premium winemaking products, mainly developed in Europe. We are now making it available for you in North America. So this webinar is going to be half an hour presentation where we are going to talk about tiles, but also how to optimize the aromatic potential of the grapes, the expression of this aromatic potential, and how to protect the aromatic profile of the wine. And we are going to talk about this through the entire winemaking process. So basically, we are going to focus on extraction, protection, expression of thiolic compounds. If you have any connectivity issue, please go on support.zoom.us and you will find all the answers you need. So before going into the process, the winemaking process, I would like to review the main thiols in wine. So these compounds that are famous in Sauvignon Blanc are not only present in Sauvignon Blanc. They can also be found in other varieties such as Vermentino, Chardonnay, Colombard, Riesling, Gewürztraminer, Chenin Blanc, and also in reds, with Grenache, Syrah, Merlot, Cabernet Sauvignon, or Gamay. We can find it in red wine, but mainly we focused on the red analysis when we were talking about making rosé. So here you are going to see three of the main of the thiolic compounds, which are the main one. So we are going to talk about the 4-mercaptopentan-2-ol, which I'm going to call 4-MMP, if you don't mind, it's much easier. As you can find the molecule here on your screen, and this molecule smells like boxwood and cat pee. Next molecule is the 3-mercaptohexan-1-ol, or 3-MH. You can see the molecule here, much higher threshold, and this one is smelling like tropical fruit, citrus, and grapefruit. Last one is the acetate of the 3-MH, so the 3-mercaptohexyl acetate. As you can see, the two molecules are very similar, but the threshold of the acetate is much lower. So when we transform the 3-MH into an acetate 3-MH, we are increasing the sensory perception. Okay, so these compounds are present in grapes. They are synthesized during the ripening process as precursors. So precursors are the same compounds as you can find here. We are finding our 3-MH and our 4-MMP here, but they are attached to other molecules, which in grapes, they are attached to a cysteine or a glutathione. So we are calling it glutathionated or cysteinylated compounds, which means they are precursors, the thiol attached to cysteine or glutathione. These precursors are non-volatile and not aromatic. There is some enzymatic activities that can be that exist that transform the glutathionated precursors into a cysteine precursor. Then, during fermentation, and with the enzymatic activity of the yeast, which is the carbon sulfur lyase activity of the yeast, we are going to release this thiol. So basically, the carbon sulfur lyase activity is going to cut where you see the scissors and liberate the thiol from the cysteine portion. And then we are going to find our volatile thiols. So we call it a liberation or a release of the thiols, which means we are making the precursors out of the cysteine part. So we make the thiol volatile. So we find back our 3-MH and our 4-MMP. We are missing one, right, from the slides before. which is acetate. So the acetate is actually arriving from the transformation, the esterification of the 3MH by the yeast to produce the acetate 3MH. So here we have our three thiols. So now that we are clear on thiols, precursors, and volatile form, I would like to talk a little bit about the main risk of losing these thiols. And then we will focus on how to optimize and express these compounds. So the main risk of losing these thiols is actually from oxidation. So these thiols are very sensitive to oxygen and can be oxidized and lost pretty easily. So you all know about the oxidation reactions in grapes and wine. They are pretty complex, so I'm going to try to summarize them and simplify them for you right now. So the story always starts with a phenol. As you can see here in this example, it's a caphtoric acid that is becoming a quinone. A quinone is a molecule with a ring and double O, as you can see on the screen. In this case, a caphtoric quinone. This transformation can happen in grapes and must via enzymatic oxidation. So we need oxygen and a PPO or lactase when there is botrytis. But also, this reaction can happen in wine via chemical reactions where oxygen is going to be activated into a radical via redox reactions with iron or copper. And in this case, we are oxidizing the phenol into a quinone. So at the end, we always have a quinone, which is the initiation of all the chain of oxidation reactions. So the quinone is going to react first with glutathione. So glutathione is acting as an antioxidant. It's naturally present in grapes. It's a very strong and good antioxidant, but it's very important to preserve it because we want glutathione to be present all the life of the wine to be able to protect it through its entire life. When quinone reacts with glutathione, it creates a GRP, grape reaction product, which is a trap of the quinone. So the quinone can't keep reacting, so we stop the oxidation of the oxidation reactions. The next reaction can be a phenolic polymerization. We know this one pretty good. It's how we get brown pigment. That's how we lose color in red wine, and that's how we make white or rosé, brown, orange. And the last one is the quinone reacting with aromas such as thiols and ester, also terpene, but at a lower extent. So quinone is a very dangerous molecule, and oxidation is very dangerous for thiols. So to protect, to avoid these reactions, we can obviously limit oxygen contact and inhibit enzymes, so inhibit PPO or lactase. We can also limit oxygen contact again, limit dissolved oxygen, and reduce the amount of catalyzers that are present in the must. Also use fining agents and remove the phenols or the quinones. So we can remove the oxidized or oxidable phenolic compounds via fining agents. We are going to see this later down the road. And we can enhance the amount of glutathione that will trap the quinone. So this stops the reaction. So we are just enhancing the antioxidant power of the grape, must, and wine in this case. Okay, so now that we know the risk, you will see we are going to talk about protection of the oxidation through the presentation, but I wanted to make sure we understood that we have to keep in mind all the time that oxygen is an enemy for thiolic compounds, so we have to be very careful with protection. So now let's talk about the process and how we can optimize the thiolic compounds and their expressions through the winemaking process, starting with the vineyards. So here you have some literature about vineyards and thiols. We know that a low to moderate hydric stress is going to favor the synthesis of thiolic precursors. Also, nitrogen fertilization and foliar nitrogen spraying are going to have the same effect. So I will let you read this publication, but this is a conclusion. So there is a lot of work that has been done and can still be done in the vineyard to increase the amount of precursors we have in the grapes. Then we are going to cut the grapes. this is all we get, but we want to extract all these precursors. To extract them, we have to know where they are present in the grapes. And so that's why I put you this graph. And this graph is showing you that there is some, there are some precursors in the pulp, but mainly the precursors are present in the skins. So how do we extract aromatic compounds from the skin? We can use enzyme. You can see in this graph some trial result where when we use the maceration enzyme, we are increasing a lot the concentration of 3-MH. And by indirect result, I would say the yeast transform more of this 3-MH, so we increased as well the acetate 3-MH. So this result is very important because the little point that you see on the graph is a sensory threshold, and in fact, by increasing, by using maceration enzyme and increasing the concentration of 3-MH and acetate 3-MH, we are above the threshold, so we pass from a wine, a controlled wine that doesn't smell any tiles, to a wine that is very expressive. Next step is by skin contact, pellicular maceration, and pressing. So as you can see in this study, the more skin contact you have and the more compounds you get, but also when you get higher in pressure, you're extracting more of these compounds. So pressure is a good way to extract tiles. Then least stabilization, thiolic precursors tends to stick to solids. So if you do a least maceration or stabilization at cold temperature, you are gonna favor the release of these compounds into the must. And then if you want to play with extraction of temperature extraction, obviously higher is the temperature, better is the extraction. So you will have much more tiles if you do a maceration at 18 Celsius than 10 degrees Celsius. But remember that if you extract all these compounds, you have to protect from oxidation and maintain your glutathione reservoir. Otherwise, you're going to lose everything you extract. One of the main steps where oxygen is very dangerous in all the one I just talked about is pressing. When you press, most of the traditional pressing are involving a lot of oxygen contact with the skin. So every time you are in a traditional pneumatic pressing, vertical, horizontal, you are, every time you deflate the membrane and you do a rotation, you are inserting oxygen through the skin and you are just oxidizing everything. So, and we want to protect against oxidation. So basically, there is two things. You have to limit rotation, limit trituration. In this case, you can think about a vertical pressing. If you press in a vertical way, yes, you will have a lower yield in juice in terms of white wine, but all the skins that you have are really compact. You are gonna go higher in pressure, so you're gonna extract more of the aromatic compounds, and you are not making any rotation, breaking the skin, oxygen contact with the skin, so you're protecting your grapes from oxygen. So vertical pressing can be a very good strategy to get more of these aromatic compounds and protect them from oxidation. The other option, if you want a better juice yield and a faster pressing, you can go for a pneumatic pressing, but using inert gas. So Bouchard-Vasselin developed Inertis, which is our press with completely without oxygen. So the concept is shown here, but basically you have a big bag that we are a reserve of nitrogen that is directly linked to the press, to the membrane. And so every time we inflate and deflate the membrane, we are gonna fill and empty the press with nitrogen. So this is a recycling system of nitrogen, and basically your entire pressing, your entire system is completely without oxygen. From the beginning to the end, the grapes and the juice are in contact with nitrogen. So that's a very good system to protect from oxidation. There is plenty of results and plenty of very positive results that show that a wine made from an Inertis is actually much more aromatic, much fresher, and much more thiolic than a wine made in a traditional pressing. For more information on this equipment, please feel free to email me and I will give you the information you need. So the next step after extracting is to increase the thiolic compounds, the thiol precursors level in must. For this, there is some products that are rich in sulfur peptides. So they are autolyzed yeast rich in sulfur peptides, which means rich in cysteine, homocysteine, glycine cysteine, glutamine cysteine, acetyl cysteine, and glutathione. And this can be used at inoculation as a yeast nutrition to enhance the amount of precursor. So I'm going to talk about Optithiol, and I just want to show you some trial results because it's pretty impressive. So if you look at the first at the graph is showing you how from control versus Optithiol at 30 grams per hectoliter at inoculation, we can increase the amount of 3MH and acetate 3MH. The graph speaks by itself, but also the second part of the graph is showing you that 9 months after alcoholic fermentation, you still have this difference that is created. The control is completely, closed and not aromatic, while the Optithiol is still fresh and aromatic and thiolic. This didn't happen just once, but many times. And you can see on the table, you have six wines, rosé and whites. And as you can see here, all of them got an increase. That's for sure going to increase the amount of thiols in your wine. So when I say this, usually the first question that comes is, great, we're increasing thiols, but what about reduction? Because some people are scared to increase the reduction as well. So we have the answers to this. We did some trials and we looked at all the negative reductive aromas that can be produced during fermentation. And as you can see in the graph, when we add Optithiol, we are reducing the amount of negative reductive aromas. The yeast is not stressed and the yeast is not producing these off aromas. The yeast is using all these sulfur peptide to produce thiols. Okay, so if we look at the application of Optithiol, it's going to be applied before inoculation or during alcoholic fermentation. It's autolyzed yeast and rich in sulfur peptides. The dosage is between 15 and 30 grams per hectoliter. The two graphs here are showing you that if we add it pre-fermentation or at the beginning of inoculation, we have a much stronger result than during fermentation. So we highly recommend to use it pre-fermentation as soon as possible. As you can see in the first graph, the second graph is showing you that the dosage is completely linear. So the more you put, the more thiols you will get. So 30 grams per hectoliter, you will get double than 15 grams per hectoliter, which is already more than double than the control that is at zero. Okay, so Optithiol is a very good way to enhance the amount of precursor in the wine, but not only, because there is some glutathione, so you are actually increasing the protection of your thiols. And also, this composition is favoring the yeast conversion. Speaking about conversion, I'm coming to the next slide, that is actually how are we going to express this potential. I keep speaking about precursors. Remember, precursors are not volatile. We need to make them free volatile as this beautiful air balloon in the sky. So how do we do this? There is a lot of studies on this topic. And here are some results. So basically, you want to ferment at higher temperature. So we are talking about 18 to 20 Celsius. To promote the expression of these thiols, you will increase the conversion rate from precursors to volatile. Also, use a specific yeast that has a strong carbon sulfur lyase activity to improve the conversion rate. So at La Montavier, we have Excellence FTH, which is our yeast that has the best conversion rate to express thiols, and as you can see in the study here, it's the best yeast among many other yeasts. So that's our yeast that we will use on any thiolic compounds. Yeast nutrition is a decisive parameter. So if you use organic nitrogen that are rich in amino acids and glutathione, you're going to increase the production of volatile thiol. So you are going to increase the conversion rate or improve the conversion rate of the yeast. The yeast is going to be much more comfortable, no stress, no need to use these compounds for her protein, but she can use this glutathione and cysteine to produce thiols. And she can focus her activity as releasing thiols. So the idea is no stress, high temperature, good nutrition. So organic nitrogen, rich in amino acids, use the right yeast. And then the last step is that you can use some enzyme that are rich in all these activities we talked about that are able to release these thiols by themselves. So this is possible too. I actually would like to speak a little bit more about enozyme TH, as this enzyme is able to release thiols not only during fermentation, but also during aging or pre-bottling. So enozyme TH, what is it? It's a liquid preparation of pectinase that are extracted from Aspergillus niger with specific side activities. These side activities are going to help you converting thiolic precursors into volatile precursors. So we are acting on the release of the thiols from the cysteine part. Okay, it's increasing the aromatic intensity of the wine freshness. And what is very good with this enzyme is that you can use it, yes, during fermentation, but also at the end in during aging or just before bottling. So in this case, you can keep some of these precursors as precursors, which are less sensitive to oxidation, and then you fine-tune the aromatic profile of your wine just before putting it on the market. So you improve the stability of these aromas because they are less susceptible to get oxidized. Also, another thing that can be interesting to consider is that yeast, even a very good yeast, for expression of thiols will never express all the precursors. So you always have more aromatic precursors that are not expressed into your wine. So it's a little bit a pity to not express everything. In terms of application, 5 milliliters per hectoliter is the dosage. If you use it during alcoholic fermentation, you are going to have the formation of acetate 3MH because the yeast will have more 3MH to work on. If you use it during aging, you will just increase the 3MH and the 4MMP, but no more yeast, so no more esterification of 3MH, so you don't increase the acetate 3MH. The very cool thing with this enzyme is that you can do trials on your finished wine. That's very easy. You take one bottle of your wine as a control. The second bottle, you put the enzyme in, you wait 2 weeks, and then after 2 weeks, you can taste the wine and see if you like it or not. So that's pretty easy to do. And if you're interested, I have samples for you, and I'm more than happy to do the trial for you. So if you do the trial, you will have this type of result. First, so you can see on the first graph on the left side of your screen, we are using enozyme TH during fermentation. And you can see on these two wines that we increase all the compounds, but also and mainly the acetate 3MH, because the yeast was having more 3MH to work on. But in total, we increase of 60% the amounts of thiols. So that's a very considerable level. On the right side of your screen, that's a trial where we added enozyme TH during aging. And as you can see here, we increase mainly the 3MH. These wines were not having 4MMP, and we get an increase of 20 to 23%. So that's pretty significant. And in sensory, you can see here below that the sensory result of a rosé or pecorino, and we have more or less the same type of result where we are increasing the aromatic intensity, aromatic quality, the amount of red fruit, tropical fruit, citrus expression, the length, aromatic length of the wine. And obviously, in both cases, the wine was preferred wines were preferred with an ozone TH. So I'm more than happy to give you samples so you can do this trial by yourself and confirm this data on your wines. So the next step is, now that we are expressing them, I would like to speak about how to preserve these compounds, as they are volatile, they are really sensitive to oxidation. We talked about it previously. So limit oxidation, which means control your free sulfur during aging, reduce the amount of catalyzer of oxidation, to use fining agents to remove copper and iron. Limit headspace, limit oxygen contact, limit dissolved oxygen. Your bottling, be careful at your bottling, and your closure choice is going to be very important at this step. Then you can still use glutathione during aging. This is a way that you to increase your reservoir of glutathione and improve your antioxidant. Your antioxidant toolbox, I would pull in your wine. So you could use some yeast hulls that are rich in glutathione, for example, such as Aroma Protect. And the last point is that it could be a very interesting approach to use fining agents to remove easily oxidable and oxidized phenolic compounds. As you remember first in the first slides, the phenols becomes quinones, and the quinone is going to trap reducing compound, it's going to trap aromas, and we are going to lose aromatic complexity and aromatic intensity. You can see the graph here where we have a control. We are in oxidative conditions. We have the control here, and when we add catechin or epicatechin, we are completely reducing the amount of 3MH we have in the wine. So, be careful with aging. Be careful with oxygen, but also limit all this oxidation reaction by using fining, by enhancing the glutathione reservoir, by controlling all the dissolved oxygen, and also reducing the catalyzer of oxidation. So the take-home message, or to summarize this presentation and conclude, so we have to build our precursors content, and this, the job starts in the vineyard. Low to moderate hydric stress, nitrogen fertilization, nitrogen foliar spray are gonna favor and increase the synthesis of thiolic precursors. Then these precursors are gonna need to be extracted from maceration, with using enzyme, pressing, least tabulation. It's great to extract them, but we have to make sure we protect them. We protect them from oxidation, so we control all the oxygen contact. During pressing, which is a very oxygen-demanding step, we want to be clever and use the tools that exist, are available for us. Inerties or vertical pressing, again, I'm more than happy to give you information on this, but that's very important. Fining, you can eliminate all the oxidized and oxidable phenolic compounds, so you will reduce the oxidation reaction. And then optityols, which you give some glutathione, so you enhance the antioxidant pool in your juice, must, and wine. You can increase the amount of precursors by using optityol. And then you have to express these precursors and reveal them, make them free, like the balloon. You want to let them go and let them get aromatic. For this, you can play on temperature of fermentation. You have to use the right yeast. Excellence FTH is going to be the right yeast to express thiols. Anozim TH is an enzyme that is going to improve the release of thiols. You can use it pre-fermentation, during fermentation, after fermentation, if you just want to fine-tune your wine. This is something very easy to try. So again, I repeat, I'm more than happy to give you some samples of it. And again, optityols is going to improve the expression, the conversion rate of the yeast regarding thiols. So thank you very much for your attention. You can email me at eglantine.chauffour@bucherwasselin.com if you have any questions. Also, you can visit our website. If you click on the YouTube icon, you can look at our previous webinar, and this one is going to be there as well. And now I'm going to open for the question and answer. Thank you very much.